Yes, go ahead, please.
So I'll be speaking on medical grade recording solutions, their limitations in short. And to start with, for any recording system, you should know your equipment. You should know your microscope, what model it is, what beam splitter you have put on it, and the C mount, whether it is proprietary or third party. I'm going to discuss all these in my subsequent videos also. So I'm just enlisting them. And what type of camera equipment do you have? I'm talking of 2D cameras here, like 3-chip, 3-chip HD, 4K cameras, or mirrorless cameras. And of course, all the fittings, whether they are tight, snugly fit, they don't have any peripheral ring protruding out, which can lead to scotomas and focusing issues. A small amount of physics is also essential for everybody to know and adjust in between the surgeries to for the optimal outcomes and the best video recording, like white balance, ISO gain, Kelvin temperature readings, dynamic brightness, and many more. To define medical grade camera is is a compact high definition capture device compatible with most output formats of medical equipment. The most important part is it should be easy to use. It has an ergonomic design, compact, and it has to be having a good functioning with easy archival properties. Mirrorless cameras I won't be discussing in detail. Basically, they have interchangeable lenses and make use of digital imaging sensor instead of a movable camera. The similarities in all these camera systems are that they have excellent video quality. And more specifically, they are excellent in low light performance, more important in VR surgeries, in vitrectomies, in which we work in a low light environment. And all of them have, a compact design. So the basic for HD video recording systems is a OR setup where you position your screen and your staff training, for the basics of, minor adjustments during your surgery. So the basics is the surgical video recording requires a lot of checks and rechecks, even in a medical grade camera. And the surgery is more important initially than its display to an audience. So new surgeons, should take it easy because they might be more conscious while doing a surgery. And this is the routine OR setup in which the, screen is over the side and it should not be in the front. So as to, if you have to recheck or check the picture quality, you just need to do a head tilt. So this is a small video of me operating, and you can see you need checks and to check the picture quality, and just a head tilt will suffice. If you place the screen in front of you, the microscope body will come and you have to tilt all your body to see the screen, and that is like this. So that will not be very comfortable, and it can hamper and disturb your surgical maneuvers. The problem with HD cameras is, it accentuates everything, the good things, even the bad things. So this is a, dirty lens, and all the artifacts come on the screen and they are displayed on the recording, the final recording also. So you have to clean your lenses properly so that these artifacts are not there. And in this case, we cleaned the lens and now you can see the picture quality, which is much more better than the previous one. And all these lashes should be, these are, not visible. They are not, they might not be that apparent during the surgery, but they really get magnified in your final product. In this case, you are doing island billing, you will tell me what is wrong in this video. But you can see the instruments, they are old, they are reused, they are reused, and they have a lot of scratch marks on that. So that also get magnified in your HD recording systems, and they have to be, if you want to show it at a competitive level, they should be new. For interior segment work, you see every surgeon has its own preference of illumination settings, and this is not a preferred illumination setting because all the conjunctival vessels are blooming. So you have to see the screen and you have to adjust the brightness in these cases. And this is a more natural color hue in which all the conjunctival vessels are visible. How much light your camera is getting? So that is a very important part. So the beam splitter, you should know the details of it. So previously, most of the beam splitters from Zeiss were coming in 50:50. That means 50% light was reaching to you and 50 to the camera. Now the newer models are the 80-20, so that's not a problem. So this is a 50-50 beam splitter type, and you can see this is optic disc pit case, and this was a pediatric patient, so I could not concentrate much on the recording part, and I had to increase the illumination for it to come optimal. But in a 80-20 part, you can see this is another optic disc patient, and you can see without any adjustments to the illumination or the brightness part, this is coming quite clear. the knowledge of the type of beam splitter you have is very essential. So the machine has no brains. You need frequent settings change, anterior to posterior switchover. So there are, you know, multiple modes for saving, you know, mode one, mode two, and you can, you know, switch over to anterior to posterior just by pressing a button. But still you need finer settings for different tissue texture and different setting. So this is, you know, a representative photo of the important part, which is the Kelvin temperature. So for anterior segment work, you need the temperature to be low because the microscope light is bright enough. When you go to a VR surgery or a posterior segment maneuver, you have to increase that light because you are working in a low light environment. So if you can see the screen, the top screen is 5000K Kelvin temperature, and that is, you know, actually more unnatural in appearance. And the lower photograph is 3200K, and that gives you a more natural photograph. And for anterior segment work, the range is around 3000 to 3500 Kelvin temperature. As you can see, this is a lower temperature, this is a higher temperature, and now this is a natural temperature because we have reduced the KA temperature in this anterior segment clip. For the posterior segment clip, this is a low light setting. We have to increase it to 5000 to 5200 to make it more naturally appearing. And this is what the vitreous looks like under the oculars. And a good idea, these both clips are of a Yamane technique which I am doing, and both clips are, you know, good in quality, but the lower clip has a Zeiss overlay. So never put a Zeiss or a company logo overlay over a recording system, because the quality of the video, you know, deteriorates a little bit when there is a company logo over it, when there is an overlay. So they might be looking you know, on a cursory inspection both good, but the without overlay clip is the better one. Another important part is the bad reflection. Whether you are, you know, focusing on a disc, whether you are injecting triamcinolone acetonide, whether you are, you know, working on a drop nucleus, or you are doing a coloboma RD, a lot of, you know, reflections from the light pipe come, and they, you know, disturb the view, and the quality of the picture is substandard, as you can see in these clips. This is a coloboma RD, a lot of reflection. So no details inside the coloboma are visible, even with the HD recording system. So you have to adjust to this. This is a, you know, subretinal cysticercosis. You cannot make out whether you're removing a band or you're removing a cyst, because there's a lot of blooming in there. So you have to take care of these conditions where there's a lot of blooming, and you have to reduce the illumination intensity. And this clip, you know, rectifies all that. As you can see, the illumination has been reduced and the light pipe is retracted towards the port. You can see every crystal of the triamcinolone acetonide clearly. And this is a cyst where you can see clearly. And these are the cysts which you can see clearly, which was not very clear in the previous clip. So, you know, recording the periphery is a little difficult than the macular part. And because the light pipe is very near to your, the cutter. So a lot of reflections from your light pipe from the cutter, you know, cause a lot of blooming. As you can see, you cannot see anything. But if you, you know, again retract the light pipe while doing indentation and reduce the illumination intensity, the periphery will be also visible, and the cutter probe will also be visible clearly. Macular recording is not that difficult because most of the cameras give a good macular recording. Just one point, when you stain it with BBG or trypan blue, you have to increase the illumination intensity because it becomes a little dark there. So for optimal quality, you just increase the intensity while you are peeling. So this is the case of a coloboma, another coloboma RD, in which all the reflections have been taken care of. And you can see even under air, the details inside the coloboma are being seen with the finer adjustment, as I mentioned before. This I'll skip. One more high reflection case is albinotic fundus, as you can see. So another point here to make finer adjustments in your ISO settings and white balance and illumination settings, so that there are no reflections and you can see the vessels even in a low contrast setting like albinotic fundus. Having said that, the best recordings are with the chandelier light. So there are two types of chandelier lights. One is the fixed one, which you can use, or one is the handheld chandelier light, which you can use. So both are excellent for recording because it gives you a diffuse illumination, like in this case. And very low amount of reflection, really excellent. This the main light has been turned off, and now I'm doing a self indentation with the fixed chandelier light. It comes up easily, but the problem lies when you go under air and there are a lot of reflections. So you have to take care while you go under air. you switch off the chandelier light or turn to a handheld torpedo light so that, see, there are so many reflections in the chandelier. Now it's a torpedo light, the chandelier has been switched off and you can see the disc and the macula clearly. So while doing maneuvers under air, you have to switch off the chandelier light. And the final, you know, video, there are multiple steps. You record in a chip and then most of these camera do not, you know, directly, you cannot edit them. Although they are in the MP4 format, but they lack the H.264 codec. So you have to, you know, embed that codec for it to, you know, be integrable into a video editing software. So I use Handbrake, which is a very good software. It is fast and it, you know, with the very less deterioration of the quality, it converts the MP4 into a editable format. And then I use the iMovie software or the Final Cut Pro for my final editing. So this is the three chip camera video. This is the medical grade video for GRT. And this is from my good friend, Dr. Raju. He's using his mirrorless cameras. All are excellent videos. It depends on what you want. So whether you want to just record videos for learning purpose and, you know, improving on your surgeries, whether you want to present them in a conference, or whether you want to compete and what your budget is. So there are limitations for medical grade cameras. They are very expensive. A lot of large files are there which are segmented and you have to collate them, and there are conversion issues. So you have to go through multiple channels for a final video product. Upgrade issues also, and performance issues in your area. For me, my take, if you know, if you ask me, the best videos are shot on medical grade cameras if all the caveats, including the price and no return on investment, is included. Thank you, Dr. Raju, for the opportunity.